Now, let me bring in the former World Tag Team Champions known as the Minnesota Wrecking Crew, Ole and Gene Anderson, and of course, they are more than just somewhat familiar with the Assassins.
Well, we sure are. You know, I guess everybody kind of counted the Minnesota Wrecking Crew out, and I guess maybe they were right. But I want everybody to know, it's kind of like the old Washington Redskins team. They took a bunch of cast-offs from all over the NFL, and they ended up with a world championship team with a bunch of guys they called has-beens. Well, you're looking at the Anderson brothers, the Minnesota Wrecking Crew, and we were the toughest bunch of guys that come down the road for a long, long time. And I know there's a lot of people out there right now that know how we can wrestle. They know how we are when we're in the ring, and there's nobody been like us before. There'll never be anybody like us again. And Assassins, you did something to me that got me and Gene just a little bit upset. So we're going to take a look at you again, and then I've got a couple of words for you.
All right, let's go back to the Omni here in Atlanta, and we'll show you exactly what we're talking about.
Down, and Anderson closes in on him. That's exactly, and now.
Georgia Championship Wrestling was a professional wrestling promotion whose self-titled TV program aired in the 1970s and 1980s on Atlanta superstation WTBS. Though based in Atlanta, the company also ran live wrestling shows through its geographic territory of Georgia. The territory was affiliated with what had been the world's top sanctioning body of championship titles for decades, the National Wrestling Alliance.
Championship Wrestling, we've got a couple of various...
Oh, and that promised to be quite a match indeed. Meantime, I've asked the superstar to come out here.
You haven't asked me, I've asked you, because I'm sick and tired of this goofball up here sitting outside of my matches interfering. I'm sick and tired of your interference, too. I told you I was going to get you out of wrestling. You're wondering where your opponent's at. Your opponent's right here, and he's going to take a pass and do it right.
Well, Mr. Stoney, I'm going to get up here and take this mask off this guy to see what he looks like. He's supposed to be so good.
Oh, Randy. Well, I'll guarantee you this much, that wrestling, too, crying as Buzz Sawyer charged, and he was wrestling to... And there you see the superstar. Wait a minute. The superstar. The Agent Plant Wrestling 2 Globe. Check it out, man. What the... Oh, man. Oh, just a moment here. He's destroying private... No, this... Oh, come on. Well, sorry, and Wrestling 2 battling it out. I don't think Wrestling 2 is even aware of what's happened to him. He is now. Wrestling 2 just made a beeline for the superstar. And it was Wrestling 2 catching. And look at Superstar says demolished. Oh, this is terrible. I don't know. There's no way that the superstar can in any way justify this sort of thing. And Wrestling 2 completely unnerved by what's going on.
Think about that, Gordon. Let the great legend think about that. Don't you love it?
Well, I'll guarantee you one thing. That's the most despicable thing I have ever seen in my entire lifetime. To take somebody's front.
Let me tell you something. Superstar, let me tell you something. This is one time, pal. You overstepped yourself. There's a lot of guys in line to wrestle you. But let me tell you, I'm no two anymore. I'm one, pal. I'm number one. And everybody, anywhere, is going to have to follow me. Because you're mine. I got you. I've got you in a match, pal. One you can't escape from me.
In the mid-1970s, Tim Woods and Johnny Walker, Mr. Wrestling and Mr. Wrestling 2, were one of the best teams in the world. They had a legendary feud with Ole and Gene Anderson over the Georgia Tag Team titles, as well as the NWA Tag titles, both of which went back and forth between them.
Hello everyone, for OneWrestling.com, this is Bill Apter, and I've got an award here, and no, it's not an award for me. This award is the Hall of Heroes, and it was given to Mr. Wrestling Number 2. Now, Mr. Wrestling Number 2 has never shown his face on camera before, and sir, do we have permission right now to...
Of course, be my guest.
We're going to put this down. Would you mind coming in close here as we drop the...
Now, let me say something. I don't know if that was a good idea or not.
Why not?
Well, you know, the light probably hit me on top of the head.
Well, I have the same problem. I have the same problem.
Oh, that's right.
Well, not as severely as you.
Yeah, you do, don't you?
Mr. Wrestling Number 2, Johnny Walker. First of all, it's such a thrill for you to get this award.
Oh, yeah.
You are indeed a legend and a credit to the pro wrestling business.
Well, you know, what makes these things happen is because you get out and you do what you feel in your heart.
Yeah.
And you do your best to be the best. There's a lot of wrestlers throughout the country that I've had to go against. And let me tell you something, they're all different. Every single one of them. You think you got it made? That's a joke. You think that guy's going to go to the left? He goes to the right. You think he's going to go for the leg? He gets a hold of your head and knocks it off. It's a treat, to me it was.
Yeah.
Because it was...
Big changes in 1972. It started promoting matches at the then brand new Omni Coliseum. It also switched its television outlet from its original home, WQXI-TV, to an upstart UHF station, then called WTCG, but later renamed WTBS. The TV show, which was hosted by Gordon Solie, was recorded in one of TBS's studio on West Peachtree Street near 10th Street in Midtown Atlanta. Shows were taped before a small yet enthusiastic live in-studio audience, as were most professional wrestling TV shows in that era. The show featured wrestling matches, plus melodramatic monologues and inter-character confrontations, similar to the programming offered by other territories.
The front of the line, the back of the line, but gradually, because I was persistent and because I was more man than the other wrestler alive, this became mine. Along with this came the $500 suit, the $100 ties, the lizard shoes, the Rolex watches, the diamonds, the gold, everything that Ric Flair has ever wanted and ever represented is mine now because I'm the world heavyweight champion. And Tony Atlas, I don't mean to degrade you as a man, but you aren't in the class. You haven't got the prestige. Sure, you're a great athlete, great body, an average wrestler, but you don't have what it takes to be in the ring with me when it comes to the world heavyweight title.
Well, I think you've made your point abundantly clear, and
excuse me, Mr. Champion, but I understand you was out here talking about me, and I want to understand exactly what you were saying about me.
Well, that's going to take a long time. So I'm going to say it real quick.
How come you can't give me a title shot?
First of all, let's make one thing clear. When they allot me time on World Championship Wrestling, nobody but Gordon Soley and myself stand here. Now, I'm talking to you, boy. Listen to me. You see what I'm telling you? First of all, you can't come out here wearing this honky shirt and those funky pants and have your hair all greased up and try and tell me what to do. I'm the greatest wrestler alive. Now listen to me, boy. I'm talking to you. I'm the greatest wrestler alive today. And you get yourself straight, brother. You understand what I'm telling you? You get yourself straight. I'm kidding. Don't start shaking for me, brother. I'll take off these sunglasses and I'll drop you like a bad habit. I'm telling you, I'll put my hands anywhere I want to. You understand what I'm telling you? I'll put my hands anywhere I want to.
Right there. Wait a minute. Wait a second. Brother, he has called his hand, and I mean he has called his hand. And Ric Flair, Tony Atlas has removed his back. Right there, we. Ric Flair up on that ring apron, and,
Tennessee, weighing in at 220 pounds, Pat Rose. His opponent now entering the ring from Austin, Texas, weighing in at 270 pounds, the sweet soul, the American Dream, former world champion, Dusty Rhodes.
Dusty Rhodes, of course, he is also the U.S. champion. And here's a man who is perhaps one of the most charismatic wrestlers that I have ever known. And he, of course, will be talking to him in an interview. Rose moves in against Rose. Full body slam. Dusty Rhodes. From Austin, Texas. Arm drag takedown. Rhodes has a great strength, great power, and very fast for a man his size, exceptionally fast. It's also quite a background on Rhodes. He's an outstanding football player, outstanding baseball player. Had pro contracts and offers both in pro baseball, pro football, and pro wrestling. And because of the very independence of his nature, chose the sport that he really loves the best, and that, of course, is pro wrestling. And, of course, he has become one of the most sought-after wrestlers in the world today. Rose having his problems now with Dusty Rhodes. Into those ropes. Forearm into the chest, another one, and one under the jaw. Rhodes fires back, catches him with an elbow, drives him to the canvas. Dusty Rhodes now closing in on his man. Rhodes brings him up high, high, vertical souffle. Crashes down. The American Dream. Inflicting a lot of punishment there. Brings him up a full body slam. Dusty Rhodes crashes down with that bionic elbow. And it is all over. It is all over. Dusty Rhodes, the victorious, went outside the ring and onto that concrete floor. The count is on. It would be a shame to see him lose on a count out, but it looks like that may be what's happening. 4, 5, 6. Briscoe got too close. That broke the count. A good break for Brad Armstrong. A good break for him. But Briscoe. Well, Briscoe possibly cutting some corners here. But he has had, as I've said before, he's had the taste of the gold. Twice world heavyweight champion. He'd like to get back into that $500,000 to $750,000 a year income figure, as the world heavyweight champion can do. Plus, there's Briscoe now. Locking in on the neck of Brad Armstrong. He has locked down on the neck of Brad Armstrong, and the referee calls for the bell. The referee calls for the bell, and Jack Briscoe emerges the victor. That means Jack Briscoe goes on. He will meet NWA World Heavyweight Champion Ric Flair in Baltimore.
Rick, you refuse to give Brad Armstrong a week.
Well, I'll tell you, Gordon, I'm here for one reason and one reason only, and that is to try to win the World's Heavyweight Championship, which Ric Flair holds right now. Now, Brad Armstrong knows that this is a tough business. This ain't no game. It's this time to get in there and go for it. The gold was up at stake, and that was always on my mind. Brad Armstrong, if he wasn't ready for it, then he shouldn't have come out to try to wrestle me, because he knew that he was hurt, and I just took advantage of it, Gordon, because one thing for certain is that I've won that championship twice before. I know the money, the prestige that goes along with it, and I want it back, and I intend on it. And Ric Flair, you be prepared, because I want that world championship for the third time, and Flair is going to be the victim.
Well, fair enough.
In 1982, Georgia Championship Wrestling changed its main programming name to World Championship Wrestling.
Albeit the comments from Ole Anderson, but right now, what I'd like to do, because there has been so many questions about this man, Roddy Piper, I thought this past week I've had an opportunity to review a lot of videotape and film on Roddy Piper, and I thought it might be interesting to try and get a look at this man and try and find out what does make Roddy Piper tick. So let's move along. As you can see here, Piper is a totally unpredictable competitor. He had a situation with Bob and Brad Armstrong, some sort of vendetta, and it was difficult to tell from moment to moment exactly what Roddy Piper was going to do next. As you can see here, Piper at the Omni, attacking a man before he got to the ring, attacking him before he had a chance to get in, and Roddy Piper so many times has shown... Piper, a man who issues pain like you would a traffic summons. He has absolutely, he appears to be totally and completely fearless. He doesn't worry about his physical self at all. He also has the capability of forgetting about law and order, taking it into his own hands. A good example right here as he decks the referee. The man, as I've said before, is such a series of interesting conflicts. And I can't help but feel that he has a lot of conflicts within himself, be it because of his environmental background or what, I don't know. But he is a man of many inner conflicts. I do know that. I would also like to say that if it were not for Roddy Piper here last week, there's a good possibility I wouldn't be here this week. Because for the first time in my life, I really felt very, very threatened by this magnificent Morocco. And again, let's take a look at this man, Roddy Piper, and what he did do that makes him really such an enigma in his own way. Let's take a look at what happened last week.
I've been associated with you. I never heard you tell anybody. I was the first one to reverse the figure four ever. I haven't wrestled NWA World Champion since 1950. Yeah, you never get on Piper's case. You never done nothing about Piper. All you ever want to do is get out of here. All you ever say is Tommy Rich. I hear about Dusty Rhodes. I hear about Roddy Piper. What a fine athletic background he's got. I hear Piper walk. Oh, yeah. Everything else. I said, you know something? Hey, you.
Oh, now, just a
moment.
Welcome back to World Championship Wrestling, Roddy Piper. Roddy, welcome aboard.
Well, Mr. Soley, it's nice to be back. You see, all of a sudden, what they're trying to do is, you see, this is what's left of Don Morocco here. We got a nice hat of Don Morocco, and they're trying to kick me off. They're trying to fire me again from TV because I cause all kinds of trouble. Well, that's okay. It'll only be the 43rd time I've been fired from something. Good. How you doing? Yeah, so they're trying to do all kinds of things because Morocco is all of a sudden mad at me.
I wouldn't exactly say mad, maybe a little upset. It's amazing. All the time I've seen you've always been on TV, always right here, flapping your jaws. I made a little statement. Oh, look, you get your hands in your pocket.
Yeah, because I'm not afraid of anything. Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's funny. A lot of people really think a lot of you, and I guess with all those little cute remarks, you're a pretty smart guy. But if you watch the TV, I don't know where you were, but I'll tell you what happened. I didn't like really what you did to me, and so I just very kindly would ask, and did ask at that time, for an apology, and I ask for it again now. An apology, that's all. Then we forget about everything.
An apology. An apology.
An apology.
For what?
Well, maybe you don't remember. I'll refresh your memory. Last week, you hit me, you know, maybe once, maybe twice, I don't know.
I wasn't here last week.
Oh, 2 weeks ago?
Oh, 2 weeks ago.
Oh, now I'm sorry. Now you're going to make, I forget, huh?
Well, I don't care.
No, okay. All I'm saying is, you make the apology. And everything is forgiven.
You know, the way I figured is this. If you would have minded your own business in the first place, you wouldn't need to be asking for an apology. And so you just simple as this. You just stay out of my way, pig face, and you won't have to worry about nothing, man. Pig face? Hey! Piper!
Piper! Ooh. Hey, no, don't give me that crap. Ooh-ooh. You tell him or you tell anybody else. You don't be talking to me like that, and he doesn't be talking to me like that, and you get his fat butt out of here, and I'll make sure we'll see you there. You get Piper!
No, I'll tell you what. We'll be back. We'll be back in a moment.
Mom, Zach, I ain't that kind of man. I'm my own man. I do what I want to. I don't agree with whatever it is. Doing,
why don't you shut up for 5 seconds? You're so good at explaining. You're so good at talking. Why don't you just say a couple little... Huh?
Keep costing me money every time I'm out here.
It's going to cost you a lot more money, Piper. I'm telling you this. You're out here and you explain to everybody. You tell everybody how this happened and that happened. I love it. Fairy Tales by Roddy Piper. Now all I want from you is an apology. And I waited long enough. Long enough, Piper. I want the apology and I want it now.
Okay, it's very, very simple. I'm going to tell you really nice. I'm going to tell you like a gentleman because I know you're a very strong man. You're strong as an ox and you're almost as smart. I am not apologizing to you.
We'll be back. We'll be right back.
Burnett was forced out in a major power struggle in late 1983. This set the stage for an important move in wrestling history involving a regional promoter by the name of Vince McMahon. Georgia Championship Wrestling was primarily owned in 1983 by a conglomerate of Jack and Jerry Briscoe, Jim Barnett, and Paul Jones. The remaining 10% stake belonged to Al Rogowski, a matchbooker who also wrestled as Ole Anderson. Other stars in the territory included Jake Roberts, Dusty Rhodes, Dick Slater, Ricky Steamboat, Nikolai Volkoff, Larry Zbysko, the Road Warriors, and the Fabulous Freebirds.
The current NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair, who has only had the title for a short period of time and perhaps has not been used to the kind of grueling schedule the champion has to keep, he could be a little over-wrestled, and Harley Race knows full well what he's facing.
Well, you know, it's kind of like Muhammad Ali. He come back for the last time, and he didn't make it. His back was in the corner, and when he come out, he didn't do the job. And Harley Race, to me, is in the same type of situation, whereas to me, it's his do-or-die match. If Harley Race don't do it this time, he may not never get another chance. So therefore, six times world heavyweight champion, and having his back in the corner like that, he might come out
straight. Hey! Now, just a minute. You and I have been drawing it around about this before. This is Georgia Championship Wrestling, and thanks to my NWA, I'm the world champion. And what in God's green earth gives you the right to come out here and make predictions about me and Harley Race?
Flair, let me just say one thing. I didn't come out here to give no predictions or no opinions either. I was asked. But you remember this. Did you ever, anytime you ever wrestled Harley Race, brother, have you ever beat the man? You answer that question, brother. You ain't never beat him. And man, I'll tell you another thing. No, I'm going to tell you something else now. I'm making a prediction now. I'm putting all the money I got on Harley Race because I hope he beats the daylights out of you. Either way, I want a shot at one of you. And if there's anything left of you when Race gets through, I hope you still have the title. But I don't believe you will because, like I said, Race, this is might be his last chance, and he's going to come out strong.
You know, you and I have been round and round about this, Gordon Soley. And what gives that emaciated-looking punk the right to come out here and make predictions about the world's heavyweight champion? And you standing here telling me I might be too hard-traveled. Well, look at me, brother. Suntan, custom-made, driving the women wild, flying in the biggest jet, riding in the biggest limousine, living a lifestyle unequaled by any other human being on the face of this earth. And whether you like it or not, whether you like it, whether Rich likes it, whether Harley Race likes it, you remember one thing. Race, you lost that title six times. And you are not going to make an example or use me to break a record tomorrow night.
Let's go and we join this match in progress. There you see the current world heavyweight champion driving that knee, but it was nicely blocked here in a back leg trip from a single leg pickup, and now Harley Race tries to set for that Indian deathlock, which of course brought him the NWA World Heavyweight Championship on one occasion.
Well, right here, you know, Gordon, I'm not taking nothing away from neither man, but you can see right here, Ric Flair, like I said last time, he had never wrestled Harley Race, and right here he's seeing what a man Harley Race really is.
Certainly no question about that. And of course, Race has an amazing repertoire of wrestling holds. And of course, one must bear in mind that he has been wrestling over half of his adult life. He began at the very early age of 17, turned in the pro ranks, and has achieved the World Heavyweight Championship on six different occasions. Here he has the Indian Deathlock on Ric Flair, the world champion. But one has to give Flair tremendous credit here because he's taken all of the pain and adversity here and continues to fight back.
Yes, sir. Just like I said, Gordon, they're both tough men. And just like I said, I heard it was a tough match. And but it's like I told Flair, you never underestimate Harley Race.
All right, both men having their problems now. And the referee looking them over very, very carefully. Of course, the world championship on the line. and watch Race now, and that tremendous determination that he has is back to his feet. And Race uses his hands very, very effectively, but it is Ric Flair, the world champion, moving out just a little more aggressively, but suddenly caught a left hand under the chin that drove him back to the ropes.
It's like you said earlier, Gordon, that Harley, he can always reach down and get something, and he don't ever slow down. You know, he knows all kinds of holds. He's probably forgot some holds in his time. And right here, but if it takes brawling and fist fighting, Harley Race will do that too. I mean, he's going to do whatever it takes, and then sometimes it gets that way.
And again, they're outside the ring now. And of course, there is more here. When I say more here than the championship, I'm referring to the fact that they have a tremendous personal animosity between the two. I don't know how you could transcend the world championship, but if it's possible, these two could.
Yes, sir, most definitely, Gordon. And right here you see that, you know, neither one's stopping, and that's that heart and the desire, because the world heavyweight title, that's almost, it's like a World Series game or a hockey, you know, the World Series, and that's what it is. That is the top in professional wrestling, and sometimes, you know, it don't matter. You reach down, and whatever you got to do, sometimes you're going to do it.
Flair got in the ring just enough to break the count, and now outside the ring once again. And so the men taking the match to each other, taking it anywhere that they happen to be. And of course, this is the electrifying thing about both men. And one has to say, of course, in the parade of long line of great champions in the National Wrestling Alliance, we certainly have a great, great former champion here, and at this particular...
That's right. I got something to prove to the people out there. I got something to prove to myself. Paul Orndorff, you're looking at the best that money has to offer. You're looking at the best that professional wrestling has to offer. And I'm going to show him right here, right now, because I'm the national champion. The power slam will prevail because Buzz Sawyer is number one, which it shows right here, Gordon.
All right, the comments from Buzz Sawyer, so let's go to the ring. Paul Orndorff going up against Buzz Sawyer. This, of course, a return match between these two. Neither man able to gain the advantage previously. Boy, and you talk about two men who are geared, who are psyched, who have the intensity. And the crowd very quickly becoming a partisan crowd. Good drop toe hold by Sawyer. And look at Sawyer trying to get in with, he tried to set up for possibly a banana split. Orndorff broke it up very nicely. And you're seeing two men going right back to the basics. Good back out by Orndorff. Good block as Sawyer went for a double leg. And they're into the ropes once again. You talk about two fantastic athletes. Scholar and elbow. This time it's Orndorff getting the side headlock. And so
Orndorff looks pretty good. And I guess a lot of people think he can wrestle, play football, a natural athlete. But right now, you're going to see. Oh, come on! What Buzz has to do is get him out of the power slam!
He's got the power slam on Orndorff, and it should be a... No, sir! Orndorff came out of that power slam. He came out before the count of three. Orndorff came out of the power slam before the count of three. He's got a lot of trouble, however. And Buzz Sawyer now trying to close in, trying to finish off Paul Orndorff. But it's the first time I've ever seen anybody emerge from the power slam applied by Buzz Sawyer. And Sawyer must be trying to analyze the situation. And Orndorff could be in a lot of trouble here. Orndorff gamely trying to come back to his feet. Sawyer after him. Sawyer continues to punish the back, going after the lumbar region. And it is Orndorff still not aggressive at this point, just trying to get back on his feet. What determination, what grit, what courage. Orndorff in tremendous pain as Sawyer closes in and continues to punish the lower region of the back. Orndorff fighting back, gamely catches him once again in the midsection. Orndorff with another hard right hand. Orndorff unloads a haymaker that time that puts Sawyer back to the canvas. Hits Sawyer now down on one knee. Sawyer staggers back to his feet. Hits Orndorff catching him with both feet as he comes in toward the corner. Paul Orndorff hanging on by sheer grit and determination. Hits Orndorff now. Great second effort on the part of Paul Orndorff. As Paul Orndorff continues to wage battle against Buzz Sawyer. Has him in a high, high backdrop. That has taken its toll on Orndorff's back, however. Orndorff
great gladiators here. Neither man willing to give an inch. Both men fighting through intense pain. And the bell has rung. The bell has rung. Neither man able to gain a pinfall in Orndorff. Totally oblivious to that bell. Just kept right on battling. But what a tremendous battle between two men who just don't know the meaning of the word.
Tommy Rich and Buzz Sawyer wrestled and brawled with each other on many occasions for almost 2 years. It was a feud that became bigger than GCW itself. Their last match is what makes the feud legendary. Known as the Last Battle of Atlanta, it was one of the bloodiest matches of the 1980s, and it was the first cage match to have a roof, which some say inspired Hell in a Cell. That was the untold story of Georgia Championship Wrestling.